We'll continue with Francesco Zaini. Thank you, Ben, again, for being with us. We'll continue with Francesco Zaini about a playground for Open Insurance. He's a Open Finance Director at G2 Startups. Hello, Francesco. How are you today?
Hello, thank you. Hello, everybody, and thanks for hosting me in this very important event. I hope you can see my screen because I had some technical problems before.
Yeah, we don't see it full screen. We see the full PowerPoint, whatever thing. So I don't know if you're able to try to go full screen
again. Apparently there is a technical problem, so I cannot do that now. I will have to go this way, and I hope, can you possibly see the slides going on?
Yeah, it's quite hard to difficult. Can we try last try to go full screen on, you know, F5 button if you're on Windows or stuff like that? Yeah, just augment the zoom, but
wait a second. Yes, I can do this way. I'm sorry about that.
No, it's okay. It's okay. I think like this it works. So let's go like this.
Okay. So can let's check whether you can see the slides working.
Yep, it's moving. Yes.
It's moving. Let's do this way.
So yep, that's good enough.
So
perfect.
It's more viable. Okay. Yep. Thanks. And sorry for this little delay. Then, as you can see from from the logos on this first slide, this presentation relates to the Open Insurance Playground, which is a joint initiative of G2 Startups, which is an innovation enabling company based in Italy, and the Open Insurance Initiative, which is a very authoritative and wide open organization and organism at the international level to establish standards related to open insurance and promote interoperability. But we'll get back to this. So I would start talking about the reason why we created the playground. And the reason is related to the opportunities and the constraints that we can see in open insurance today. We'll start speaking about open insurance, but also we'll mention the ecosystems, the business ecosystems, because this is one of the potential change the insurance industry can go through, which is enabled by interoperability and open insurance means and tools, basically. So we start from here, and we start from the reasons why things are changing and we decided to go this way. There are four major megatrends that impact the insurance industries. The industry, as other industries actually, but specifically on the insurance industry, have an interesting impact. The first one is the fact that the platform economy and the PI economy are not only at the door, but are already there, and they are influencing the way consumers are behaving. And in fact, this is one of the reasons why there are higher customer expectations, and of course, the expectation that everything can be found very easily, very quickly, online, if that is the choice of the customer, with very very quick feedbacks and end of the process in a very short period of time. Also, another impact that we can see is that the barriers between and among different sectors are basically decreasing and sort of being teared down by big techs and other big players in the market. And finally, what we see, which is a specific impact of, you know, the COVID crisis we passed through, is that there are bigger protection needs apparently today. There is a perception of a difficult and, you know, hard situation for families, and so this increases, you know, the need of protection. And that doesn't mean necessarily that the offer is there to take care of that and take advantage of that, but that's a point that has to be taken into consideration, of course. So, who are the most likely winners in this new rules of the game? We can see some of them here. The big techs, because already, you know what it means to go beyond sector barriers. Full stack insurtech startups, because they really can change the rules of the game. Also the providers of insurance as a service, because they would enable, you know, companies from other industries to enter and you know, in the turf of insurance companies, incumbents from other industries, in fact, and insurtech startups that are already ready to partner with incumbents or intermediaries or third-party providers. So this is, you know, the scenario, and the traditional insurer carriers are sort of stuck in the middle, because they usually are, you know, quite comfortable in staying in a comfort zone, and have to change. In order to change, there are many different manners, but certainly there is a way that can be a good solution, or anyway, a good help in order to cope with these threats in the future. And that is open insurance. So the insurance industry should open in order not to be, let's say, overwhelmed by this new situation that is at the door. Having said that, the situation doesn't, let's say, resolve itself in a very short way and without going through some major change. So the API economy actually enables open insurance. Enables open insurance and also facilitates the change in the business model of insurance companies, because the traditional vertical integrated mode may not work so well anymore in the future. Probably it will work only for specialized companies and or for the biggest companies in the arena, whereas for the rest there should be some kind of choice on whether to position themselves. So either, you know, product company or a distributor or, you know, an integrator, but maybe in a niche, not in the whole market. It will be more difficult to be a generalist company in the future. But there is also, you know, the possibility and the capability in the outside to allow them and enable them to assume new roles. The as we can see here, this is you know, an image that has been sourced by an EIOPA discussion paper on new business models. I mean, the whole value chain, insurance value chain, is impacted by change and by technology. That's certainly not true for all of us. What is interesting also to say is that there are basically four main innovation types, product, channel, process, and business model, that impact the different steps of the value chain, and they have also different impacts, and also can be impacted themselves in a different manner and at a different degree from open insurance. Our appreciation is that open insurance is relevant, particularly in the case of change of business model. We mentioned the ecosystems before, And also very much in the product and channel innovation area, is probably less relevant for process change, where you know, innovation can do a lot of good, but not necessarily through the interoperability with startups or with incumbent of other sectors. So that's a preliminary consideration that we do. And that brings to this point. There are three, in our opinion, three major streams of innovation that can be acted by insurance companies in the future, and they are still already working, you know, many of them in, the, in these three areas. One is product channel transformation. The other is business model transformation. And then finally, as we said, we have a radical process improvement that can be very relevant, although maybe a little bit out of the scope of open insurance. Then, if we want to see some examples, product channel transformation has to do with many things, many innovation in product and in you know, collaboration with intermediaries or with final customers that we can see these days. So parametric insurance, which is very cool these days, instant insurance, pay-per-use, bottom-up coverage, which means that basically insurance companies provide the coverage according to needs that have been defined by intermediaries or by the customers themselves. Well, business model transformation has to do with mainly with ecosystems, business ecosystems, in the two possible forms, embedded insurance and ecosystem orchestration. We'll see that later. But that also be, you know, business model transformation can be also, let's say, triggered by pure bundling of services. And certainly, platformization is something that is going to happen in the future and not necessarily will be performed by insurance companies, but they can play a role if they want. In the process improvement side, what I would mention, which is absolutely critical, apart from the increase in efficiency and the effectiveness of the processes, is the user experience management. This is really important, you know, for the future of the industry. You know, an industry where, you know, the providers generally have one, maximum two or three interactions with the clients along a year, of course, are not so used to focus on the user experience. But the user experience management in the future will become certainly key. So that's a point that we all have to keep in mind. Having said that, let's get to the ecosystems. I see that the time is running, so I have to go rather quickly. There are at least three areas of high value generation in going towards ecosystems. The first one is risk management. And this is something interesting because while ecosystems are value generating for any industry, in insurance, there is this additional benefit. Then through ecosystems, you can take under control and have a better control of the generation of risks and of their remediation at the end. So for example, if you team up with a company or a startup that provides, you know, the monitoring of IoT sensor in the home of the customer, then, of course, you can, to a certain extent, prevent the negative event, and so reduce the claims, reduce the cost, and reduce the frequency, basically. Also, you know, these events can be mitigated in terms of severity, because if you have, you know, an emergency call and you reduce the impact of the event, of course, the cost for the company will be lower. And finally, the remediation. You know, you can have a remediation in kind. Instead of paying back the customer for the damage you went through, then you can remediate yourself through repair, etc. And that can be done teaming up with external companies. We'll see that later, a little bit more in detail. It's important also that dealing with ecosystems, we take into account the whole life cycle and the customer journey of the customer, and the journey of the customer, because that is possible through the ecosystem, and that is a big advantage the insurance companies can take from this model. And it's something that goes beyond the typical constraint of having a few interactions with the client, along their life and their time. And finally, it is a fact that where there is a very proactive attitude of insurance companies and the insurers, towards the needs of the customers, and they use the platform platforms and have a platform strategy, then the returns are much, much higher. So is a fact. Then just a look at the life cycle view, and this is the case of home ecosystem. We can see four basic phases: the purchase, the renovation, the management, and the sale of the house. And if we focus on the management phase, where the insurance company has the best possible impact, there are many possible services that can be covered, including, of course, the insurance services, but including also other services like safety, security, and maintenance that are linked with the risk management, as we were mentioning before. Others can be used in logic, in an approach more of service bundling, but still can create additional value through revenue sharing, for example. And finally, final point of this first part, is that the insurance company can either be an orchestrator or a partner of an ecosystem managed by somebody else, which is the kernel of embedded insurance, if you wish. Now we have to run, because the time left is really limited at this time. Let's describe the playground and as it started. So as I said, the Open Insurance Initiative and G2 startups teamed up, set up the playground in Italy, but only because we started from here. Our purpose is to go beyond the national boundaries, and is something that has an international view, if you wish, and can be extended in other environments as well. And in fact, we created two levels. The first one is the Italy Working Group of OPIN, which is the Open Insurance Initiative, which gave birth to a few months ago to the playground that is operated through two other technical partners, which are Tesobe with the Open Bank project, and D4Next, which is a local startup, but with a very, very future-proof view. Then I will go very, very quickly through the purpose of the approach. I can answer two questions of this, and I can tell very quickly that we'll publish a standard of open APIs and best practice on the three use cases that we have selected. Very quickly, we plan to do it within the end of the year. These are the three use cases that we have selected. So is the booking of health services with instant coverage, the prevention and monitoring of gas leaks at home, and the home insurance policy quotation and issuing. We have an architectural frame, so we have a sort of virtual platform within the playground, and these are, you know, some details of what we are doing, what is our program, our plan in you know, setting up the whole thing within the playground in the three, with reference to the three use cases. So we have a specific journey that we are designing. We have a purpose, which is generally to develop APIs in connection with the insurance companies. And the approach is to design the information flow, define or adapt the standard taxonomy, and use our virtual platform to test and develop the APIs. Here you can see some of our references, like for example our website open-insurance.it, and if there is any need to get in contact with us, you can see, you know, in the bottom right also the email address, and I hope that this quick overview can be of interest for you. But now I open for questions if there are any. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, Francesco, we have one question I was reading right now from Dennis. He said, he mentioned that what you say is a little bit like it was for open banking. And he asked a question about if open insurance will be regulated and mandatory for insurance market.
That's a very good question, because in fact it's something that, could be also included in the presentation, but I take the chance to speak about that. Because in fact, it's true, you know, some principles are the same, or, you know, basically the main principles are the same. And, you know, banking and insurance are two very regulated industries. So they have many things in common. But in relation to open insurance versus open banking, what they don't have in common is the regulation for this point. Because, you know, we all know that PSD2, at least in Europe, is the prevailing regulation for developing open insurance framework and services, open banking framework and services, whereas we don't have a parallel regulation in that sense. We see from what is going on the documents of IOPA and what is the attitude of IVASS in Italy and the other local regulators, that we don't think there will be at the gate in a very short time a regulation that is similar to the PSD2. But what we ask to the regulators, and we have responded to IOPA, to their document, is to have, a favorable regulatory field. In Italy, for example, they are starting with an InsurTech sandbox. We met the Italian regulator recently. We are interacting also at the European level, and certainly they are also interested in understanding what we do in a market-driven sort of sandbox, because the playground is a sandbox, basically, in the way it works. Of course, it's not a regulatory sandbox, and they are interested in understanding how things are proceeding and if and how we can, find some synergies between the regulators that wants to understand a little bit more how to regulate, because they will certainly regulate to some extent, but probably in a less, let's say, proactive manner than, you know, they did with PS2 in open banking. So to get to the point, at the end of the day, at this stage, open insurance is more a way to differentiate on the market than a way to comply to a regulation.
Yeah, so you don't see any roadmap for implementation so far on open insurance regulation anywhere in the world?
No, well, no, we know that in the rest of the world, certainly, you know, that there are, you know, it's different also for banking, you know, because the only region in the world where open banking is so highly regulated is Europe. And in insurance, it's not happening exactly the same way. For example, what we can see at the open level, at the international level, is that Brazil, for example, is going that way. It has a roadmap and is going step by step into that direction, using, by the way, the Open Insurance Initiative taxonomy and the open insurance initiative, let's say, framework to get to that point, because it's the most readily available framework in the market in this moment.
Yeah, that makes total sense.
We see a lot of interest in understanding how to regulate, because they want to regulate, okay? Probably not as much as in banking, but not a roadmap, let's say, in the in Europe, UK, and US in this moment, I would say.
Yeah, that makes
sense. As far as we can see.
Sorry. Thank you very much, Francisco. We reached the time we had for this, but glad to know more about the G2 startups and the Open Insurance Initiative. Open. Don't hesitate to share the links where we can follow more of this work. And if some insurers or if some insurtech wants to be to onboard the work you're doing, don't hesitate to share the link to know where they need to, where sure. They can reach. Thank you, Francesco.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.